Hi, my name is Kevin Thomas, W1DED. Today I have with me Glenn Petri, KE4KY. Glenn first came to my attention when he was speaking in Visalia about being a Dxpedition pilot, but his experience in ham radio contesting and Dxpeditions goes far beyond that. He started back in the mid-70s and has a rich history in the hobby, so I'm looking forward to talking to him today. Glenn, thank you for joining me.
Hey, thank you very much. I appreciate the invite.
So I certainly want to hear about being a pilot for a Dxpedition because, you know, frankly, I'm not really that familiar with that role, but there's so much more that we need to talk about before we get to that. So why don't you start with just getting your license in the mid-70s? What was that experience like for you?
Well, I started out as a youngster. I was 12 years old. In 1975, I went to a novice class when the FCC still had the novice class structure. And actually went through a several-week class learning the code and learning the material to pass the written test at the time. And so at 12 years old, in the fall, almost winter of 1975, I received my first call of WN for CSH. And I was I went to the novice class to accompany my brother, Daryl, WA4CAQ, who is also still licensed. And of course, being the older brother, I wanted to follow him along, and so I followed the older brother to the class. And whereas he kind of veered off later in life with the technical side of things, I've kind of stayed more into the communications and the upfront stuff with the operating and so forth. So there was a lot to learn. I had a ton of Elmers, some very patient Elmers. And even today, it's kind of funny how you never outgrow Elmers. There's always somebody around the corner that's helping to teach you something, or you pick up little details as you venture into different aspects of the hobby. So my first radio stations when I was a youngster were not very fancy. They were a single transmitter, single receiver, and just a simple dipole. And then my brother and I, we eventually got a Hustler 4BTV vertical and got it on the air, so we're not just stuck on 40 or 15 meters. And then eventually he bought towards the our high school days a Yaesu FT101EE, and man, I thought I died and gone to heaven when I finally had that radio sitting in front of me. And I kind of noted that, and we'll talk about it a little bit, cycle 21 was in its peak at that time in the late 70s. I graduated from high school in 81. So in the years leading up to my graduation, I would come home from work, or come home from school, I should say. And there was all this DX on the weekends, and I tried to contest a little bit with them because I knew there were stations that I wanted to work that were DX, but I really didn't know what kind of jewel I really had at the time as far as DXing was concerned. And then when the second cycle came around, as I was a little bit older and in my first home, cycle 22 in the late 80s into the early 90s, I actually had a decent antenna system. And actually that's when my DXing quest really took off, was in the period of about 86 to 91. So I've experienced ham radio as a beginner with a very Spartan station. And now I'm very pleased with the station that I have set up now. So it's kind of interesting to look back on the history of it myself and kind of smile and look at my homemade QSL card and so forth.
Well, I certainly appreciate the concept of Elmers that you brought up earlier and that you had a lot of them. And you're right, that tradition still stays alive today in ham radio. And frankly, it's why I started this YouTube channel. I was getting back into the hobby myself a couple years ago, and the best way to do it was to reach out to people like yourself and others to learn more about the hobby. So I'm really thankful that it's a community of people that really want to help each other out. One of the things I've got to ask, though, about you and your brother operating the same station, and we all know about sibling rivalries and the fights that brothers can have. How did you work out the usage of that station? Were you pushing each other out of the way, or did you have a little schedule made out for yourselves?
Well, I think since he was 3 years older than I was, obviously there were things that he had going on in his life during high school, and I was in middle school. That we didn't have a lot of conflicts there. I think the only thing that much to the dismay of my mother when we went to Radio Shack, that was thankfully very close to our house, was I wanted my own straight key because I said it's just too hard to adjust the straight key every time I sit down. But other than that, it went very, very well. And I think we collaborated on some receiving antennas for the standalone receiver, and got up in the attic and ran some wire for that and so forth. So it was a collaborative effort, and it worked out pretty good. Not very competitive on that aspect.
So Glenn, I certainly understand that contesting and DXing are important to you, but at some point along the road, you decided Dxpeditions and actually going on Dxpeditions might be important to you. And I think you went to Campbell Island, Mellish Reef. Tell me about that. What was that that like, number one, but how did you get those invites? How did you get that first one under your belt?
Well, it's very interesting. I was a member of a local DX club, and one of the things that we would do occasionally is watch one of the videos from either Bob Alphen, his produced videos, or one of the James Brooks videos. And it was very interesting to me, and I always thought that would be the pinnacle of being able to do in your DXing career is actually go on the Dxpedition and be a Dxpeditioner. Well, funny thing was, in 2012, when ZL9HR was first announced, the two Australians that were leading up the team put out an open call for operators, which you don't see that very often. And so I sometimes feel like I lead a blessed life. And so I had a local friend, Jim, K4TXJ, a longtime DXer and local icon when it comes to DXing. He sent me an email and he said, here's your chance. And so with ZL9HR, I sent out an email and I said, I'm highly interested in finding out more about the Campbell Island Dxpedition. Well, it wasn't 24 hours later that I was getting an email back that said, you're on the team. And I sent an email back immediately and I said, well, I got to talk to my wife. And it was kind of like, well, if you want to go, you need to tell me now. And my wife and I had talked about it briefly. And so sure enough, I was on the team for a ZL9HR. I had never traveled outside of the U.S. before. Actually, my travels inside the U.S. were sort of limited. I had gone to some of the sites out west, like Yellowstone and the Grand Tetons, but not an extensive traveler by any means. And so here I was, my first trip outside of the USA on a very needed entity. It had been a while since Campbell Island had been activated. And so it was that Dxpedition that I was able to meet Gene, K5GS, Les, W2LK, Dave, K3EL, and Pista, HA5AO. And from there, the team, the Perseverance DX group, was formed. And what was interesting about the Mellish Reef Dxpedition in 2014 was I got a call from Gene that said, well, our team is going to Mellish Reef, and we want to know if you want to go. You're on the team. And I said, well, what team is it? He goes, well, we don't have a name yet, but we're a team. And so I said, sure, count me in. I think it's something that I could swing with no problem. And so I let the wife know, and I said, hey, I'm on a team, and we're going to Mellish Reef out in the Coral Sea. And she goes, well, maybe we ought to talk about this. And I said, well, I think this is something that I can do, and we can fit it in the budget, so I'm going to go ahead and do it. And so she was very supportive. And then following that, the Perseverance DX group, as you may ask questions about, as we may talk about, with just the completed Clipperton Dxpedition, has really gone to some very good places, some very much-wanted entities, and it's just proved that they're an exceptional team with exceptional leaders that put together very good Dxpeditions to these locations, and are really rewarded with a lot of accolades for what they do.
Well, that's a remarkable story. As somebody who interviews a lot of people that have been on Dxpeditions, I know that being invited and getting one of those slots is pretty rare. And for you to do that so quickly, and it sounds like you didn't know any of these guys ahead of time. So what was that like being thrown into the deep end with them?
Well, what was interesting was after the formation of the ZL9HR team, our first meeting with the USA contingent was in Dayton that year, because it was announced prior to Dayton And if I recall, we met at Dayton, and then the Dxpedition was to occur like in November of 2012. And so we set up a spot that we would meet at the old Hera Arena, and we actually went to a local restaurant and we sat down. We started talking to each other and getting to know each other, and it wasn't difficult, but it was certainly one of those things of they didn't know me, I didn't know them, and I don't think they knew very much about each other either. There were some commonalities that came out, like Les and Gene had both worked for IBM. So there were some things that immediately they were able to form their friendships very quickly. As far as the team formation, it went exceptionally well. I think the good thing about the Perseverance DX group is that the core group of people that have led the Dxpeditions all throughout the years, the last decade, very cohesive group of people. They've gotten to know each other very well. And then anybody that's been added into the mix has always been of the mindset, tell me what I need to do, give me the assignments that you need me to do, and I'll get them done. So there's a very good work ethic in the whole group.
So tell me more about the DX Perseverance group. I know you've just explained the genesis of the group, but what are some of the Dxpeditions they've gone on since?
Some of the Dxpeditions that they've gone on, of course, Mellish Reef in 2014. We actually had one to planned Tango 31 Whiskey to Central Carabas in 2017, but it got canceled for an unforeseen reason that popped up, so we decided not to go ahead and activate that, and they put their minds to other things. But in 2015, I did not go on the Chesterfield Reef TX3X. I assisted with some back office duties, assisted a friend of mine that was our pilot, Ralph W4HK, a local here in Louisville. He was the pilot for Mellish Reef, so I assisted him in some other back office duties with TX3X. Also, PDXG has gone to Ducey in 2018, a very, very well-planned and produced Dxpedition. And then right as COVID hit, the team was in South Orkney with VP8PJ in 2020, and a very good Dxpedition that the stories that they tell about on their way back, they're all lucky that they got home before all the airports and everything got completely shut down. So the Dxpedition ended just in time for everybody to get home as the world was facing the COVID issue. And so then, of course, in the team and every team that's out there is always looking for places to go that are interesting and that the DXers worldwide will want to look at their operation and say, yeah, I want to work that, whether it's for a new one or a band fill. And so there's always lots of times where these teams, they'll start laying plans for a particular entity, and the group that controls that particular aspect of land or island says, no, you can't do that. And so then you go to the next one. And so fortunately for us, we were able to get to Clipperton, and it was a process. And you need to have Gene on your show sometime to talk about Dxpedition planning. But basically, sometimes you just don't stop asking at the first no, and you start trying to work around the no's and the obstacles and the roadblocks. And eventually there was somebody that said, yes, let's look at this. And so earlier this year in 2024, we were able to go to Clipperton Island, and a team of 16 operators from six different countries, I think it was, put on a fantastic show. It was a very difficult Dxpedition to do from a standpoint of it's not a very inviting environment. It's very difficult to work in the heat, the humidity, constant sun. There's no shade unless you make it. And so, but a very cohesive team, and we just had a blast. And we understand that the DXing world just absolutely just thought we did a fantastic job. And we're very pleased that we were able to do that for the DXers across the globe.
So Glenn, if the Perseverance DX group was basically founded somewhere around 2012, at least the first Dxpedition was then, has the core group remained the same over this past decade?
Well, I think one of the things that we've seen is like with any venture, it less W2LK probably doesn't travel as much as he would like to. We're all going to be there someday as we're getting older and so forth. And so Les has not gone on a couple of the latter Dxpeditions. The core group of the team is basically the same. But I think you have some people now, and I hope I get everybody's call correctly, Steve, W1SRD, Rob, N6QT, who's done Dxpeditions on his own and very accomplished, has also become an integral part of our team. And so there's several people that have gotten on towards the end that are now a very integral part of the planning, whether it be for antennas or logistics or whatever. And so, the primary people are still there, but we're always adding in and bringing in, newer and better talent.
Well, I've got to say, it's impressive that core group has stayed together. I know in my conversation with Max George, NG7M, after his return from Swains, he was explaining to me that a lot of people focus on, you know, the operators and operating in a Dxpedition. But he was commenting on the dynamic that has to exist between all the participants, because you're traveling a great distance with them. You're there on an island with each other. You're having to cooperate to build things and tear them down, to problem solve. So there's that teamwork that happens even before or during what you're operating, which was a great perspective for me. And again, it's impressive that your group has stuck together all this time. So let's go to Clipperton, TX5S. I believe that the Northern California DX Foundation named you Dxpedition of the Year. It's very impressive.
Yes, they gave us their DXcellence Award for this past year. And what it was based on is club log criteria. They have some standard criteria that they look at as far as all-time new ones. What impacts did you have on logs across the world? And so we were very humbled and very grateful for that recognition through the NCDXF, which was a major supporter of us, by the way.
So let's move into piloting. Again, I didn't really understand this concept. It's not something that I recalled from my early days in ham radio. I took my four-decade break, came back into the scene a couple years ago, and it was a term that kept coming up. What is a Dxpedition pilot, and what does that role look like?
Well, let's first dissect the word, and we'll launch this rocket right at the beginning. A pilot is a term that many people may associate with travel, such as the person who pilots a boat in and out of a port. Pilots were used in the old days with steamships to get them in and out of a particular dangerous harbor or inlet, because the pilots knew exactly where the sandbars and all the different obstacles were that could wreak havoc with the getting in and out. And so a pilot is just somebody that steers a ship, sets a course or sets a path. It also in the tool world is it guides, or it's a means to be able to use just a little bit of knowledge or a little bit of to be able to, well, I'm stumbling my words here, but basically what the pilot does is in the tool world is it's a guide, like a pilot hole from a drill or something like that. And so in the DX world, what we have seen over the years is who are these pilots that are part of the Dxpedition team on their website or whatever. And so when I was asked to do a program in 2014 it was quite later than that. In 2019, Dave K4SV of the W9DXCC asked me to do a program for the W9DXCC convention about what is the role of the Dxpedition pilot, having come off the Ducey Dxpedition. And So when I started looking up data about what is a pilot, how can I incorporate this into my program? What I found was there wasn't very much written about piloting and Dxpeditions. The only person that I found anything on the internet was from Lee Jennings, ZL2AL, a Canadian who found himself living in New Zealand in the latter part of his life. He's now a silent key. Actually wrote on his blog the role of the Dxpedition pilot. And I can say quite certainly that many of the points that he brought out in his blog are just dead on for the roles that we have as a Dxpedition pilot. Basically, what he observed was that the Dxpedition pilot is a screen door between the Dxpedition team and the many callers. Regionally, we're a collecting point for information as it pertains to propagation. We provide the real-time feedback from the Dxpedition, the DXers that then contact us about things that they notice, things that they see going on with the Dxpedition. And the Dxpedition pilots, because we're outside of the Dxpedition, obviously we may be able to see things and observe things that are going on with the operation that the operators themselves cannot see. And a lot of that has to do with propagation, timing, and I'll talk about that in a minute. And so it's a good way to get a daily report card back to the team about exactly how you're doing as far as the Dxpedition team itself. So basically, I took a lot of what I had observed myself and some of Lee's comments and created this program for the convention. There is really no playbook that any Dxpedition pilot uses. Each team sets up the role for the pilot. They may be the face of the Dxpedition when it comes to press releases, or they may not. So actually, each team decides exactly how much involvement the Dxpedition pilots will have with the outside world, other than just an email address to be contacted. So one of the other things that you try to do whenever you're creating a pilot or a pilot team is propagation is not the same everywhere across the globe. So get regional pilots. That way you can get 24-hour feedback or feedback through a 24-hour period about how propagation is going, what is going on with the Dxpedition, and the things that are noted by the people that are trying to get into the log. One of the things that we also find about Dxpedition pilots is it's a great way to get involved with a Dxpedition team, so that maybe someday, if they have an opening, you'd be one of the first ones that get called. So I would encourage anybody that knows a group of guys that go on Dxpeditions frequently just to throw your hat in the ring and say, I'd like to be able to help you out with some aspect of the off-island team. That way, when the opportunity comes up, they already know how you work with the team. They pretty much have a report card on you so that they incorporate you into many of the other aspects of the operation, and then hopefully you'll get on that island yourself.
So Glenn, would it be accurate to say that it's also a way to protect the operators so they aren't in the line of fire, having people shoot off emails to them asking for various things? They can just direct all that traffic through the pilot?
Well, that's pretty much the concept, is that and of course we'll talk about changing technologies a little bit, but up to this point in time in history, the operators really don't have a lot of easy access at times to the internet. It was very expensive to be able to use an Inmarsat phone, or Inmarsat for data, and then the satellite phones and so forth, in order to be able to contact and send out either emails or receive emails, send pictures, receive pictures, or anything like that. One of the things that we've noticed is, and if it's able to be used, Starlink was with us on Clipperton Island. We actually had a terminal that was up 24/7. We had a spare one just in case something happened. That way we could update logs. We could send as participants in the Dxpedition, we were able to stay in touch with home a lot better. But yes, the Dxpedition pilots, the whole role of that is to be able to funnel your observations, your complaints, things that you note about the operation through the pilot, let them filter that out, and then the lead pilot, the chief pilot, can then get all that information from the other pilots globally and then send that report card to the Dxpedition team either once or twice a day. Obviously, if there was a Dxpedition team leader who had his email that was being bombarded with how in the world can he do what he's supposed to do as far as operating, getting the amount of sleep, the amount of work that needs to be done, it takes one less burden off of him to be able to just have one succinct email from a single or maybe even two sources to say, this is what's being seen, this is what's being heard of your Dxpedition. So yeah, it's a good filter, and the Dxpedition pilot can take a lot of stress off of the Dxpedition team of not having to worry about dealing with the Dxers directly when it comes to some of those issues.
So Glenn, I imagine that the regional pilots, maybe even international pilots, are all working through what I'll call a chief pilot. I don't know if that's a term or not, but that one person is sort of the conduit. How does that chief pilot determine what's important to send back to the team? Because I think it would be reasonable to say there's a lot of conflicting interests, right? You can't make everybody happy. So how do you determine what gets reported back to, say, Clipperton when you check in with the team?
Well, I think there's three major areas that the pilot first needs to concentrate and be focused on. And the first one is anything that would seemingly affect everybody. And what I mean by that is, in the world of FT8, of course, we know the clocks on everybody's computers, so timing, making sure that if there's something that's really askew, that the team knows about it, and hopefully they have the tools at their disposal to be able to fix such an issue. Another one that comes to mind as well is like RTTY, not used as much on Dxpeditions anymore, but it's still a viable mode, and many people do clamor for it, but is sending RTT in reverse, just a minor mouse click, could really ruin somebody's day if you're the Dxpedition of sending in or receiving in reverse. And so an issue like that, to say you need to check your settings. Another thing would be like on CW, is if you have a particular station that for some reason the timing gets out of whack and the radio amplifier connection is dropping the first dit, or it's a truncated first da or something like that, being able to report, hey, the guy that's on 20 meter CW this morning, there was something wrong with the connection because we were losing the first dit and the first part of his transmission, you can tell that there was something wrong with it. So that kind of information is good. So anything that would seemingly affect everybody. The second thing that we want to talk about is propagation, because certainly what's happening, like on Clipperton, we were not difficult to work from the U.S. at all. However, in our antipode, certainly on 80 meters and 160 meters, we could have had a little bit of an issue. And so in dealing with polar propagation and so forth like that, it's kind of good to be able to get feedback on real-time propagation reports. And things like 10 meters is open these hours for this particular region. So after the Dxpedition gets up and going and starts getting into its stride is when we can start fine-tuning the operation. Give it time to get going, everything get up and running, but then these reports can start filtering back and the Dxpedition leaders can say, we need to start staying for Europe a little bit more on 15 meter CW at these particular hours. Or let's say the 80 meter window for Eastern Europe, we're leaving way too fast. There's too many people saying, you're still loud and you're switching off an operator or going to another band too quickly. And so those type of reports are extremely, extremely important. And if you think that the team is doing a good job, send an email to the pilot and say, hey, you all are doing exactly what you need to do to be able to get people in my area of the globe in the log. And so that's the kind of report that we would like to see. The other thing is timing. And as I kind of alluded just a second ago, sometimes what can happen with a de-expedition team is you're sitting out there and you're thinking based on propagation reports that you set up before you got set foot on whatever island or whatever entity that you're at, this is probably what I need to do as far as times and bands. Well, the things that we learn is that propagation is always fluid, it's in flux. And so maybe what we need to do is get reports back to the island team to say, hey, everybody is saying that you are leaving 10 meter phone too early or you're getting there too late. Just with any band or any mode, you can take your pick. So the timing issues about making sure that we don't leave too soon, that we're working out the band because the band is open at particular times, and just make sure that we get as many people in the log as we can, as efficiently as we can. And so those timing reports are very important as well.
So who at the, well, first of all, is chief pilot, is that a term that's used?
Yes, commonly it's used, yes.
So who would the chief pilot be communicating with in the expedition? Is there a team leader, or are you communicating with various people running various stations?
What we do is with the regional pilots, generally what we do is we try to get our friends in Japan to have a single pilot from Japan. We'll have another Asian pilot. We'll have Alex 4L8A, I believe is his call, in Western Asia. Then we'll have a pilot in Europe proper. Usually it's somewhere like around France or Germany. We'll have somebody in that particular area. Then, of course, we'll have somebody from New Zealand and Australia, Oceania, to be a pilot. We'll always try to have one in South America as well. So with our team, with me being in North America, it's very easily to be able to be the North America pilot and the chief pilot. So typically what they'll do is they'll email me the information, their observations, and then what I'll do is I'll put them in a bullet point email and send it to the on island team. And so that way they don't have to go through all of the verbiage, all of the paragraphs of what's just little bullet points about this is what's being observed here in Australia, this is what's being observed here in South America, this is what's being observed on the 160 and 80 meters for our friends who are the furthest away, the antipode of the operation. The other thing that's been very interesting, and we tried it as an experiment for VP8PJ, was we created a group's IO account just for the Dxpedition. And what this was going to be was a relatively unfiltered, loosely moderated. If somebody got too wild, we'd deal with it. But we didn't want to have a heavy hand in it at all. And we wanted everybody globally to be able to connect to the group's IO page. And even our own pilots would do so as well. And what we found, what I found was that sometimes people could vent. And on that particular web page, and I could still incorporate their comments. I could thank them for their comments. I would not have a heavy presence there, but if somebody pointed out something that was useful, I would just do thank you for the info. It'll be passed on my next update to the team. Sometimes it was self-correcting. If somebody got on there and said something that was completely incorrect, other members of the group's IO page from all over the globe, they could get on there and said, no, that's not correct, that's not happening. And so it would quell a lot of bad information as well. And we found this to be a great stress relief, pressure release valve for the regional pilots as well as the chief pilot, because everybody had a single place that they could see what everybody else was observing. And fortunately, our pilots were able to interact. I was able to interact, and it came across very well, and it was taken very well. Of course, for Clipperton, we did the same thing, and we were able to create the group's IO page for the people as well as the other pilots to be able to have a place to congregate, to look at the reports, and to show what was going on. One of the things that's bad about information from Dxpeditions is the last source that you want to have is places on the internet that have forums. A lot of times, information could be misconstrued, it can be made up, it can be completely false, but yet once it hits the internet, then it becomes like wildfire. And so the other place you don't want to get information is from the local DX cluster, either the cluster comments. So I would suggest that anybody that wants to follow a team about everything that's going on with the Dxpedition is look at those sources like the DX bulletins. And you know the ones, the one that Bernie runs, the Daily DX. There are many good ones that come from the German DX group. There are several other ones like DX World and DX News. Carl does an excellent job with his from DX World. Alex 4LA is one of our pilots, and he's one of the producers is the producer for DX News. And so obviously what you want to look at is for official sources. And for our team anyway, we make sure that there's bulletins or notifications that go out to the to our partners that run these bulletins. And that's where you need to get your information from. Certainly not from a forum on a web page or from the DX cluster. Give you a quick example. Back a couple of years ago, I believe it was VP8PJ, there was all of a sudden this wildfire rumor was that computers were dropped overboard and logs were lost. Well, that nothing like that happened at all. I don't know where in the world that came from. And one of the few times that I actually interacted with somebody through the group's IO page, I sent a private message and said, I don't know where you got this, and it would be appreciated if you wouldn't spread this kind of stuff, because it causes a lot of unnecessary mayhem. And so basically all that was said was back to me, well, it's what I heard. And so basically follow the official sources and release sources that we do through our partners to get news about the Dxpedition.
Well, it certainly makes a big difference when a Dxpedition is taking a proactive step, like you are with pilots. Not only are you bringing information into the Dxpedition team as on island or whatever DX entity, but you're able then to communicate something professionally to the ham radio world, which probably didn't happen as consistently back a decade ago. Glenn, I really appreciate you taking time today to have this conversation. Obviously, a stellar ham radio career, but also this information about Dxpedition pilots, very interesting. Thank you for joining me.
Hey, thank you very much. I had a lot of fun doing it. I hope that some people, and one thing I want to leave everybody with is whether you have a complaint or an accolade or an attaboy for a Dxpedition, go ahead and send it, because that's why we're there. And teams want that kind of feedback. And what I tried to do as a pilot was not only pass on the observations and possibly the complaints, but when somebody would send an email to say, hey, you got me on the honor roll, I thank you for being there, or this was my number 340th DXCC entity in my quest for gathering the all of them that are out there that are available. So we want to pass those on, and we want to make sure that the team understands that they're being heard, they're being accepted, and they're doing what the DXing population wants them to do, and that is provide cues and get them in the log.
My name is Kevin Thomas, W1DED. I've been talking to Glenn Petri, KE4KY. If you've enjoyed the show and you've been following WNDED worldwide, please subscribe. Thank you for joining me, Glenn.
Thank you.